Swadharma is discovering the devotee within. And these three components of dharma, dharma is the cosmic flow really. And in this flow, I participate. I meaning at the level of the body, mind, sense complex. We don't look for an equality there. Because at the level of what we call the cause of the universe, there are so many differences. This is what is called, the differences are, you know, too big, like bigger than the Grand Canyon, too big to be bridged. This is the big, huge difference. How can you have the temerity to say, I am Ishvara? Who is the one who is saying? You know, how can the person even speak and say, I am Ishvara? This is possible only because that with which this consciousness is associated with, whether you talk on the side of Ishvara at the level of the universal upadhi. Universal upadhi means what? Every tree, everything, all the five elements, everything, the one who is the maker of everything, who has all knowledge, who is all pervasive, who is God, who is the cause. And whereas this jiva, who is small pervasive, small knowledge, who feels small, who feels odd, not God, who feels because, not the cause. So where is this difference? This is a huge, big difference. So the difference is on the level of appearance alone. Because that same Brahman, that consciousness in relation to Bhagavan, is in relation to an upadhi that is a limitless upadhi, is called Bhagavan. That same consciousness in relation to this 5 foot 10 inches is called jiva. That same consciousness alone. Oh, but then the consciousness has associated with something. No, that association can only be between two things that enjoy the same order of reality. Correct? Otherwise, how can there be an association? So, satyam we already saw. What is that? What is satyam?
Existence.
What kind of existence? Limitless existence that cannot be negated, that is unchanging. Abhaditam sat, trikalepi tishthati iti sat. So, limitless, unchanging existence. And that is associated with what? Changing. Changing finite things. So, when the infinite associates with the finite, what prevails?
Infinite.
Naturally. Because the finite is included in the infinite. Finite is not an entity by itself at all. The word finite is an offshoot of the infinite really. The finite, the word is only a point of view. Infinite is the view. You cannot confuse the point of view for the view. You can only appreciate a point of view for itself. So there is no concept of finite at all. Really, it is not there. Why? Because whenever you say finite, it's already a comparative thing, correct? It's based upon something that doesn't come to an end. So who is the one who says finite? Yours truly, me? Who is this me? Infinite. It's only the infinite that can cognize the finite. This is so fantastic. If there was no infinite, you could not call anything finite. But the fact that you lament, everything is coming to an end. Who is saying that? Sad Ananda. Yeah. The misery is also upheld by that limitless infiniteness. Misery is upheld by the Ananda. That's why even sadness when you feel, you can say, I'm close to Ananda. It's the Ananda that is upholding the tears. And it's Ananda that's upholding the fears. So those are two entirely different orders of reality that cannot be compared at all. One is a point of view, the other is the view. And like I said, the view cannot be confused with the point of view. It's disaster. But how to understand this? shirt and fabric. Simple. One person calls it shirt, another person, after having a few years of Vedanta, says what? Fabric. I see fabric. Who is correct? Both are correct, correct? It is shirt, it is fabric. Both are right. So if both are right, they should be synonyms. The word shirt and fabric, are they synonyms? That is my question to you. Even at the grammatic level, they are not synonyms. So if both are right, and if both shirt and fabric refer to the same thing, they should be synonyms. But they are not. One is the substantive, the adhishthana. The other is that, a superimposition, a name and a form, a word and meaning. Fabric with a word and meaning is called shirt, t-shirt, whatever you want. Fabric plus something. There is a certain alteration, pun intended, happening to the fabric. That makes it into a shirt. And that alteration can be either quote-unquote human-made or, you know, it's creator-made, doesn't matter. But that alteration, that substantive has undergone an alteration when you say, is that alteration real as the substantive? No. It cannot be. So the substantive is what here? Fabric, correct? Oh, but you have to alter the fabric, you have to cut, you have to stitch. So the fabric has undergone an alteration, then you cannot restore it back to fabric. That's why we have more than one example in our arsenal, Vedanta arsenal. What is that?
Clay pot.
Even clay undergoes a glaze and a kiln and a baking process. Even better example we search.
Golden ornament.
Ornament and gold, every ornament, the shine belongs to gold, its weight belongs to gold. Every jeweler is a jnani, gold jnani. Yeah, not an ornament jnani. He will weigh. And you say, oh, this is great grandma's necklace. He doesn't care. It has no sentimental value to him whatsoever. No, but it has all ruby studded. He will unceremoniously, right in front of you, take the tweezer and pluck out all those aforementioned rubies. Yeah. He doesn't care. He won't even look at the making charges. You're not going to get that back. He will only see gold. He will also mentally minus copper and silver, whatever is needed to mix into that gold. He will minus that and give. Gold jnani. This is what it is. So without undergoing any change, that gold manifests as earring, nose ring, bangle, bracelet.
Space and shape is also.
Bangle, bracelet, anklet. Whatever you want to let it be, gold becomes that let. Yeah. It lends its existence. Million ornaments, how many golds?
One gold.
Million pots?
One clay.
Million rooms? One space. So therefore, we see that the substance with which these items are made of, is unchanging, and the items themselves, what is their reality? What is their satta? What is their satyam? There is only one satyam, correct? And that is already appropriated for the gold, for the fabric. That is appropriated for the gold. So you cannot use the word satyam. There cannot be two satyams. Why not? Because otherwise it will not be anantam. The satyam we saw was without any, you know, limits. So there cannot be two satyams. How many satyams can there be? Only satyam. Okay, so the word satyam has gone to gold, to the fabric, to the clay. Now, what is the reality of this pot? What is the reality of this shirt? What is the reality? You cannot say it is non-existent shirt. That you can say only if it is emperor's clothing. You've heard that story, right? The children's fairy tale. Non-existent shirt. If the shirt is existent, it's covering me. I'm wearing it. It has a purpose. It has a name. It has a form. It has a word. It has a meaning to refer to it. It is real. Because I can interact with it, I can feel the material, I can say this is polyester, this is cotton, this is silk, I can delineate the material. So in a way it is real because it is available for transaction. But it is not as real as Sat, correct? It has reality. What kind of a reality? A reality that is limited to a functionality, a transactional functionality. So you cannot say it is non-existent, you cannot say it is asat. Asat means totally non-existent. And so the Upanishad says that you have to refer to this by a special word. All these objects in the universe, which are dependent upon sat, which manifest, you know, as words and meanings, names and forms, associated with sat but dependent upon sat. And you cannot be dismissed as non-existent, cannot be ratified as existent on their own. What is that? That word is mithya. Mithya ornament, mithya pot, mithya body, anything that depends on something else, mithya. And what is that something else? You keep going, 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 something, 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 Brahman. Even clay, first you say clay, pot depends on clay. What is this clay? Molecules, particles. And then you have to go to Brahman only. Ultimately everything depends on Brahman. So like even a dream universe that you project in your own dream, Brahman, we say, has projected this Jagat. And so the status of the projector is also mithya, really. As mithya as the fabric. Sorry, the shirt. So the status of one who is projected and the one who comes under the spell of the laws, that is also based on the upadhi. So that is also mithya. In other words, Ishvaratvam is mithya. Jivatvam is mithya. Don't say Ishvara is mithya, no. Jiva, the Ishvara hood, the status that there is such a thing called Ishvara, that is mithya. And on the other side of the equation, this side of the equation, jiva-hood, jiva-ness, that abstract noun, when you put tvam, not in the sense of you, but that as a suffix, jiva-tvam, manushya-tvam, tat-tvam, that tvam suffix means abstract noun, which has a direct translation, ness, N-E-S-S. Jiva-ness, Ishvara-ness. So this complaining, why me individual? And the one who makes the individual complain are both mithya. The status is mithya. Mithya doesn't mean false. Mithya means that which is a projection of the sat. A finite dependent projection. That's all. That which depends upon sat. So this is what is called lakshana. Lakshanaya we have to understand. Through lakshana. Lakshana means the definition. And there are many kinds of lakshanas. Here is you retain something and you let go of something. You retain what? That which is the substantive and common to both. What is common to Ishvara and Jiva? Let us see. What is that?
Brahman.
Starts with B. Brahman. Yeah. Starts with B. Brahman. Yes. Or Atma. You can say that also. Doesn't matter. And so this Brahman alone, in other words, consciousness, that limitless consciousness plus an overarching upadhi, a limitless upadhi is called Ishvara. That overarching, you know, upadhi, when it is a finite upadhi, it's called Jiva. That's all it is. And so you remove the upadhi, not literally, cognitively, figuratively, and all you gain is what? Limitless consciousness. That is why even the most miserable wave can say, I am the ocean.
Before it thought it was just a notion. Before it was sad. Sad wave, boring wave, upset wave, small wave. And it had lost all its waviness because there was not much, shakti in this wave. And then it was given the Mahavakya Upadesha. Oh, what is that? That sounds wonderful. What you just got, that is what it is. Mahavakya Upadesha. It was shown the non-difference between itself and the ocean. So it said, you are the ocean. No, 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 how can I be the ocean? Ocean is Bhagavan. I am just some idiot. Ocean is huge. I am small. Ocean is all. I am a non-entity. And it was taught, no, 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 you are made up of water. Ocean is made up of water. If anybody has to touch the ocean, all they have to do is touch you. You are the ocean, you are the whole. Then it said, wow, this is wonderful. I am free. I have moksha. It started to wave again to everyone. It was very happy. And then it said, I am free. I have moksha. I am free enough to inhabit this miserable body, this dilapidated mind and these nonsensical senses. I am okay to inhabit. I am free. I am okay. And then what happened? That is what is called jnana. Then it became a Devananda. And then that is what its new name. Yeah. It was renamed Devananda. And so too this miserable jiva. I am miserable jiva also has a tiff with the ocean. Which kind of ocean? Ocean of samsara. Ayayo. I have fallen into the ocean of samsara. Help! Why me? Someone hear my cry. Where are you, O Bhagavan? Why are you playing hide and seek? Give me your darshan. Better still, lift me out of this mess. So the jiva started to compose sad songs. Yeah. That's why instead of satsangs, we should name them sad songs. Yeah, really. Sometimes whole groups of people, all they do is sit and sing sad songs. Really. All longing songs. And everybody sits and cries. And then you feel good because everyone else also is crying. You thought it was only you. And then, that's why they say misery loves company. Yeah. So here, this jiva was sitting and singing sad songs. And the jiva also got Mahavakya Upadesha. Jiva also, finally some grace prevailed, went to the Guru. Not only went to the Guru, did not fight with the Guru, stayed with the Guru long enough to get the knowledge. All this is important, yeah. Did not misunderstand the teacher or the teachings. Had the grace somehow and had the free will to persevere till the teaching was totally received, understood, assimilated. Maham brahma nirakuryam. Mama brahma nirakarot. Anirakaranam astu, anirakaranam me astu. Tadatmani nirate, ya upanishatsu dharmaha, te mai santu, te mai santu. All those dharmas of the ideal student that are told in the Upanishad, may they abide in me, may they abide in me. What a beautiful prayer. That is really the prayer of the mumukshu. You don't need any other prayer. Apyayantu mamangani, may all my angas, my limbs be protected, be healthy, my body be healthy. Vak pranash chakshu shrotram atho balam indriyane cha sarvani. So this includes all the karmendriyas, jnanendriyas, organ of speech, hearing, eyes. Let them, perceive everything with clarity, acuity. Sarvam brahma upanishadam. Everything is Brahman as it is detailed in the Upanishad. Maham brahma nirakuryam. Therefore, if everything is Brahman, may I never turn my face from Brahman. Can I go anywhere from Brahman? Yeah? If I go to the next room, am I away from Brahman? No. Then why does the Upanishad say Maham Brahma Nirakurya? Mentally you can go away. Yeah. Meaning you can be in a state of self-denial. You can be in a state of self-denial, self-sabotage, a continuous state of self-sabotage, where you keep, you know, cutting the limb on which you are sitting. That is why, Maham Brahma Nirakurya. Mama Brahma Nirakarot, may I never feel abandoned by Bhagavan. Because the jiva's lot is to feel abandoned. At the drop of a hat, even without the hat dropping, I feel abandoned, I feel lonely. So this is to avoid that, we say that. Mama Brahma Nirakarot. Anirakaranam astu, anirakaranam me astu. May there be no denial for me from all directions, from all sides. May I never deny the existence of anything. May I be in a place of receptivity and acceptance. This is a beautiful prayer. And that which the Upanishad describes as an ideal student. Tan atmani nirate yaha Upanishad su dharmaha. So all those dharmas of the ideal student, Shraddha, Bhakti, Titiksha, Samadhanam, Shamadama, Viveka, Vairagya, may they abide in me. May I qualify for this knowledge. So this is what the jiva must have prayed. Which jiva? The one in our story. The quintessential jiva. The one who is full of peeves. May as well be called piva. So this, the jiva prayed. This jumping jiva that I was describing earlier. And the prayer, of course, has a result. Every action has a result. Prayer being an action has a result. And the jiva prayed, and the prayer was answered. And the jiva understood that I am the whole. The ocean of samsara in which I have fallen is but a notion. When the whole ocean is dismissed as a notion, this is magic. This is Indian magic, Vedantic magic. We don't even need the rope trick. You know, there's one Indian rope trick. Even Adi Shankara describes that in the Mandukya Bhashya. You know, the Indian rope trick is where the rope just, you play the pipe, that same thing that you play to the snake. You see, there is some snake rope similarities we have seen in other classes. And so here the rope apparently rises and goes to the sky in this rope trick. Adi Shankara has also witnessed it and he writes about it. And then a man climbs on the rope and also goes away somewhere in the clouds. And then declares from the cloud, I'm not coming back. And then later on comes through the back door from the behind the curtain somewhere. So obviously it's some kind of sleight of hand or mass hypnosis. And this is the Indian rope trick. But we don't need any rope tricks. If we know the original trick, what is that trick? Aropa. That everything is an aropa. That's why it's called rope. Yeah. Because it's aropa. Aropa means a superimposition. It's an as though superimposition. The status of Ishvara is superimposed upon that consciousness. The status of this miserable jiva who is crying, why me, three times a day before food, before each meal, is also superimposed upon that endless, limitless consciousness. All there is that consciousness which undergoes no change to project as Ishvara, to project as jiva, just like, you know, over a lamp when you put a cover, a clay cover with two holes, one small hole and one big hole. When you make the room dark, then you see two lights, correct? One is a huge light coming out of that big hole projected and one is a small light. And then when you uncover, you find that there is only one light. It is neither big nor small, it is everything, it illuminates without residue. That is what one is. So, but because we live in a manifested universe, understanding this cognitively is not always easy. We need to help ourselves through certain validating practices. And one of them, as we have been speaking about, is surrender. We have to surrender to this Bhagavan as a way. This is the best way of transcendence, is through surrender. Who is surrendering? The miserable jiva is surrendering to the Ananda, the source of all Ananda. The limited surrenders to the limitless. What is left is limitless. That is why we have 108 names, 1008 names, 10,008 names, 100,008 names. And if you look at all these namas, these names, we find something which is very common. What is common? You know that the source, Abhayaya Namaha, the source of fearlessness, I surrender. Namaha means surrender. To that which is the whole universe, I surrender. To the one who is the source of all riches, I surrender. Who is this I? The one who feels poverty surrenders to the source of all that is rich. The one who feels sick surrenders to the one who is all healthy and free from all kinds of illness. The one who is angry surrenders to the one who is oceanically calm, you know, like a calm ocean. The one who is a miser surrenders to the one who is, you know, the abode of all prosperity. The one who is irritable surrenders to the source of compassion. And that being the one's real nature, when the limited surrenders to the limitless, what is left? Limitless. There is no limited anymore. That's why puja, chanting, etc., there is a certain limitlessness, there is a certain absorption, because the limited individual, the complaining, why me individual, ceases to exist for a time being. Giving enough reprieve, giving enough time to really understand this. And if one is also pursuing the knowledge, that alone is not enough. If one is also pursuing the knowledge, this clinches the whole deal. Clinches it. And the knowledge along with the bhakti helps to open the heart, to surrender to that which I cannot control. And who is this I? At talking at the level of the Namarupa, the Jiva. So I accept that I cannot change. Not only accept, first I grumblingly, mumblingly, fumblingly accept. And then I accept joyfully. This is how it is and it is okay. It is okay, it is okay. Tathastu, tathastu, tathastu. Last time I taught one word. What was that? Sthane. Very good. Sthane. It is in place. How can it be in place? I want it to change. Sthane. My want is also included, you see. That I want it to change is also okay. Sthane. That it is not changing is also not okay, but I have to pretend it's okay. Sthane. Sthane, sthane, sthane. That everything is okay. Somebody wrote a book, you know, you are okay, I am okay. Gore Vidal, you know. We have to retitle, and we have to bring out another title. What is that? You know, I am okay even if you are not okay. That is, this is the Vedantin. This is, there is no dysfunction here. This is the functional Vedantin. I am okay even if nothing is okay, I am okay. That is what it is. And this is the secret to Ananda. And I told you, you know, we are going up Manushya Gandharva Ananda, Deva Gandharva Ananda. How to go beyond that? You know, there must be something beyond that. Ajana Janan Devanam Ananda, Karma Devanam Ananda. How to get there? Remember the motel analogy, correct? So first the house becomes a hotel. And then what? Rent a child, rent a spouse. That we talked about that. And then what? Rent a body. Next level of Ananda, you have that same hotel relationship with the body. You check in, that is called birthday. You check out, that is called tithi. Yeah. A date of checkout. Check out of the body. Yeah. Check in, check out. That's all it is. And when you are here, you enjoy. I mean, this is like a hotel room. I mean, it's perfectly ventilated. When it gets too hot, it takes out excess water and then you feel comfortable again. And when it's cold, it eats a lot and puts on weight and gives you a nice cushion. Every winter, yeah. The body is intelligent. It has its own intelligence. It's a wonderful room for this jiva to live in. No, but what do you mean it's a wonderful room? It falls sick, it has got chronic, all kinds of chronic conditions, it's got autoimmune. Now everyone is having some autoimmune something, yeah. And it's got all these things, still it is a perfect, this is the room that I have been given. No, but I want to complain. Yes, you can complain to the management. in the form of prayer. You can go and register, I want a change of room. Sometimes you may get it, you know. Be careful what you ask for. I want to change the room, here is my key. I give up. Bhagavan may say, okay, theek hai. You know, try this one here. And sometimes you don't like this, you know, I don't like this American body, I want Indian body. Okay, next time, theek hai. Indian body. Still American mind, wants to go to America all the time, you know. And sometimes American body, but cannot get away from idli sambar all the time. I know some people like that also. All they eat is dosas, idli, sambars, 24/7. Naam ke vaste American body. That's why Bhagavan doesn't need cable TV. You know? Achha hai. Any jiva he looks at is a private reality show. This is what it is. We are the entertainment. So you can complain, I don't like this body, it is full of aches and pains. You can complain, you can pray. But better to understand what this body is and what matters is the one living in the body, not the body itself. Then you are free enough to abide in a complaining, dilapidated body. So it's okay, theek hai, no problem. And this way, the body itself, when it becomes a hotel room, you know, the eyes are the windows, yeah, you have nice view, you have 360 degree view. You have, you know, that's what in the Bhagavad Gita is described, Navadvare Pure Dehi. This fellow living in the city of nine gates, all these orifices are called gates, portholes, like, you know, in the cruise ship. So this body is cruising along and you are there, this body is the hotel room. Minimum upkeep, you know, you have to keep it, you know, you have to get up, you have to brush teeth. If not for yourself, as an act of social service. And for the same reason, you have to take shower also, you know. It's a civic act. You have to minimum upkeep. And because you don't want to freak other people out, you have to wear some clothes, you know. This is all on the level of utilitarian basic upkeep. If it falls sick, you are the one managing trustee of this hotel room called the body. So on that level, you are the one to take care of it. You are the one to give it Tylenol or whatever it needs. You have to upkeep it, take care of it. And then when you check out, you give the key back, finished. This is what the whole thing is. Oh, so we have reached the level of Indra? Yes, we have reached the level of Indra. So if you have this kind of a relationship with the body, you will have Indrasya Nanda, according to Shankara. But then after that, how to get Prajapati and Brihaspati and all that? For that, we have to go to another level of discussion. What is that? The mind. Yeah. Now, what do you think? The mind is me. I have this feeling, oh my God, this is real. This is what it is, this is absolutely real, I have this feeling. And by the time you say this is real, the feeling has gone. You have not even noticed it's gone, you are hanging on to something that you felt yesterday. So that here again is a letting go. The mind is just a receptacle of thoughts. A mind is a little pot where the knowledge is placed, that's all. So the knowledge of Brahman, the knowledge of myself as Brahman happens in the mind, but not, the mind is not a knowledge of agent of which knowledge? That is the mind. The mind is not the agent. The mind is the recipient of this knowledge. Because there is no agent here of this knowledge. We had already said there is no knower. There is no known. How should to communicate that? Where to communicate that? The faculty of knowing, of course, needs to be there. But it is something that gains this knowledge without being the agent of this knowledge. This is very important to understand. So the mind is another motel room. It's a motel room of thoughts and ideas, where the artwork on the walls are my own thoughts and ideas. Sometimes I encounter a happy painting, sometimes a sad tapestry. Samsara is depicted on the wall of this room. I attach to the observer. take everything in stride, look and enjoy the mental museum of tragicomic artwork. That's all I do, without becoming a participant, without identifying with it. And that same Ananda of Brihaspati, everything, that same Ananda of Brahman belongs to who? The one who gains this knowledge. So the more the Vairagya, the more the Ananda. This is what it is. So if you want to enjoy everything, possess nothing, control nothing. The less the control, the more the Ananda, the less the fear, really. And this is how we started, by talking about the Upanishad as the repository of the knowledge that removes sorrow and removes bhaya, fear. Sorrow and fear it removes. And here, in the Taittiriya Upanishad, it says, sorrow is because of hurt and guilt. Kimaham sadhuna karavam, kimaham papam karavam iti. Why didn't I do the right thing? Why did I do the wrong thing? This is the lament of the jiva who identifies as the doer. Doer is me, I am not the doer. Body is of course me, I am not the body. I am not just this body. Much more than this body, much more than this mind, much more than doer, much more than the bhokta, the experiencer. These are the five levels of mistakes. I am not the mind. Mind of course cannot exist without me. I lend sustenance to the mind, but I am not the mind. This is what is called pancha kosha viveka, the five loci of error. Kosha is not some sheath, you know, like you take the sword out of the sheath. Adi Shankara talks about it. And in fact, the Upanishad does not use the word kosha. Koshavat achhadakatvat kosha. That which covers like the sheath is called kosha. What does it cover? Your knowledge. Don't say it covers Atma. What can cover Atma? Nothing. Nothing can cover Atma. That nothing can cover is Atma. The covering agent, if there was one, is Mithya. So how can that which is the light of all lights be covered? It cannot be covered. So it's not a covering as much as a covering over my own clarity, which leads me to make the error that the body is as good as myself. This is a locus of error. And there are five such loci of error in the form of the body, the prana, the breathing, the mind, the sense of doership, and the sense of experiencership, that are beautifully outlined in the Upanishad, in this particular Upanishad. And those, that viveka we have done in these last two classes. That is what we have to do. We have to have that observer status with regard to all these loci of error. Loci is the, what is the plural of locus. You cannot say locuses. And that means those locusts, you know, yeah, we are not talking, calling them. After 17 years, cicadas came, and I don't know after how many years locusts will come, so let's not invite them. But loci of error, the place where it's very easy to mistake, because the body, there is a kind of a belonging, you know, because of this association of sat and mithya, the mithya, you know, identification with the mithya, that is the place where the mithya, when I identify with the mithya, I make the error. And that, those are the five places: body, prana, mind, and then what? Doership, experiencership. Doership means the guilty fellow. Experiencership means the hurt fellow. This is what it is. Guilty, hurty, that's what it continues. So these are the levels of errors which inhibit the Ananda, which I already am, which inhibit the manifestation and the enjoyment of Ananda. So the more I have Vairagya to these five areas, the greater my freedom is, the greater I can enjoy this world, enjoy myself, enjoy Bhagavan, which is all one really. Jiva, Jagat, Ishvara, it's all one. So the increase in Ananda has nothing to do with the status, with the possessions, with some kind of a big mantle. The increase in Ananda has to do with the decrease in my own control, with the decrease in my own possessiveness over certain things which were never mine to begin with. If you own one thing, you become tied down to that thing. If you possess nothing, you can own everything, really. That is the key. So if you want something badly, let it go. Stop controlling it. Enjoy it. That's what it is. Somebody said it will come back. I won't say that. I won't give false promises. It may not come back, but it's okay. Enjoy it anyway. You know, somebody said if you love it, leave it, it will come back. It may not come back. One thing I can promise is that you will be transformed. In order to see yourself as big, Brahman means big, limitlessly big, you have to give up the identification with all the small mithya things and inconsequential things in your life. That is the connection. That is the reality. And so this concomitant increase in Ananda has to do with increase in Vairagya. And like I said, Vairagya is not giving up objects. It's giving up the relationship of possession and ownership with that which doesn't exist, really. Oh, but this is my body. It doesn't even exist. It does not conform to the definition of Sat, which is non-negatable. Is the body non-negatable? Why it is taking so long? Is the body not negatable? No? Is the body unchanging in past, present, future?
No.
So how can it be Sat? This is the Viveka. This is what is called Panchakosha Viveka. This I have to exercise throughout to get out of this guilt and hurt. And then going back to this whole question of fear. When I own nothing and I have everything, when I possess nothing and everything is mine alone, everything is me alone, when I have that, it is called Sarvatma Bhava. Everything is me alone. And at that level, you know, there is no bhaya. There is no fear because there is no second thing to make me afraid. That somebody or something will take my yoga kshema away, it's not there. So beautiful. Nothing can take me away from this. It is an as though gain of that which is already existent, which is self-existent, which is self-shining, which happens to be the cause of the universe. At that level you can say, I am Ishvara. I am that which is the whole. Because I have already cognitively bypassed the upadhis. I have bypassed the miserable upadhi of the jiva and bypassed the all-pervasive huge upadhi of Ishvara. And all I see is that shining consciousness which is everything, which is limitless. So you can be happy for no reason. No reason at all, you can just be happy. And that's what the Upanishad again says. That usually people who are enlightened are mistaken to be mad. Yeah. This is what the person who knows this knowledge breaks into song for no reason. Taittiriya Upanishad says, starts to sing Samaveda. Hau, hau, hau. Ahamannam, ahamannam, ahamannam. I am food, I am food, I am food. Ahamannadaha, ahamannadaha. Ahaggishloka krit, ahaggishloka krit. I am the one who is the composer of the Veda. Suddenly the person is thinking, singing, chanting. I am the eater of the food, I am the food, I am everything. I have no limits. The person is there. Why? Because of this Ananda alone. This Ananda that one is searching is the most hidden thing. Why? Because of the misidentification with what is called the five levels of error. The five loci of error. Big mistake. And what is this mistake? It's not a mistake, it's a misidentification. I'm as good as the body, I'm as good as the prana, I'm as good as what I do, I'm as good as what I think, I'm as good as what my karmic lot is. This is the problem. And when this is interrogated, eliminated through knowledge, then you become the person sitting under the tree. Shrotriyasya cha kama hatasya, check, first level of ananda gained. Then what? How do you get the second level of ananda? You keep studying, keep studying. Teye satam manushyanam anandaha, sa eko manushyagandharvanam anandaha, check, shrotriyasya cha kama hatasya. Akamahata means here, the one who has transcended desire. Because what is this desire for? The desire is to gain something that you already have. No, but I want a promotion. Really, do you want a promotion? Yes, I told you I want a promotion. Who are you to question it? Really, what does that promotion represent? Happiness. Really, you have to come back to that. Security. And that you already are. So the second level of ananda is gained. Shrotriyasya cha kama tasya. Shrotriyasya chaka mahatasya, Shrotriyasya chaka mahatasya, that becomes the refrain, the chorus in this whole section. And the Upanishad is so beautiful. This is why I love the Upanishad. Because I talk to you about the variable and the invariable, correct? So the Upanishad in this beautiful passage has presented the variable ananda belonging to certain status of Indra, Vayu, Agni, Manishya Devatas and these Devagandharvas and the Karma Devatas, ancestral realm. But the invariable Ananda belongs to the fellow sitting under the tree. So beautiful. Shrotriyasya chaka mahatasya, that which is invariable in every Ananda, this person has penetrated without becoming Indra, without becoming, this person has conquered that, without becoming any Devata. That status Ananda has left, that status you don't need. If you know what is backing up that status, that adhishthana you are, that is where the real ananda lies, not just an experiential ananda based on some kind of a mental change. We are not talking of that. That is called ananda maya, that is called the bhokta. That is what we dismissed. Ananda maya means a vikara, a modification of that we are not talking of. We are talking of that which is the basis of Anandamaya, the adhishthana of Anandamaya, which is Atma, which is Ananda itself. It is not a special experience. Why? Because every experience is that alone, is based on that alone. If it becomes a special experience, it will become finite immediately. So we are talking of that which is the truth of every experience. The one who is free to experience everything, including sadness. When you are experiencing sadness, it is ananda that is projecting the sadness. Crying, you can say, I am ananda. Sad ananda. That's what it is. Frightened ananda. Irritable ananda. Angry ananda. You can give yourself a name like that depending upon the mood. It will really work to bring viveka. You can do that. Right now, I am irritable ananda. Right now, I feel tamasik, tamasananda. I feel rajasik, rajasananda. Oh, today by mistake, accidentally, I feel little sattvik, sattvikananda. Today I feel calm, kamananda, compassionate ananda. Of course, by the time I finish saying compassionate ananda, the compassion has departed. Doesn't matter. From whom that vigata compassion ananda, you can say that. Vigata means from whom the compassion has departed. But it is ananda that is upholding all these states. That which is stateless is what I want. Statusless and stateless. And that is what is constant. That is what is limitless. And be sure that it is not another experience, because if it's another experience, it becomes variable, it becomes finite, it becomes elusive. Sorry, I should say it remains elusive. And so therefore, this limited, the variable and the invariable are presented so wonderfully. Anything that you can multiply, which has gradations. Is it variable or invariable? Variable. Ah, abba. This is the happy moment in the life of the Vedanta teacher. Something has gone in. I'm so happy. Yeah. The Vedanta teacher should have only one qualification. Oh, I thought two, Shrotriya, Brahman, forget all that. Here only one qualification. What? he or she should be very easily pleased.
Yeah.
So, this is what it is. So, this is that which can be measured, that which can be divided, multiplied, added on to, is mithya, is variable, is dependent upon that which is free of addition, subtraction, multiplication. So, listen carefully now to the refrain, to the whole verse. Saisha anandasya mimamsa bhavati yuvasyat sadhu yuvadhyayakah. Already little more is expected. Ashishtah tradishto balishtah tasyeyam prithivi vittasya purnasyat. Saya eko, already we are counting. Saya eko manusha anandah. Then that which is not counted is chanted. Shrotriyasya chakavah tasya teye shatam. Now please multiply this ananda by 100. Then you get one unit of manushya gandharvadam anandah. Then you look immediately at that which is not multiplied. Shrotriyasya chaka mahatasya. Then you multiply. Teye shatam. And these 100 times of manushya gandharvadam anandah yields one unit of deva gandharvadam anandah. Then that which is invariable. Shrotriyasya chaka mahatasya. We are not saying multiply the Shrotriya 100 times. No. Shrotriya constant, correct? Akamahata also constant. Now, like Adi Shankara says, there can be a growing clarity. Okay, theek hai. That's different. The growing clarity is centered on that which is not growing. Brahman is not growing. Brahman is not putting on weight. Clarity is putting on weight. That's good. We need to feed that clarity. Then what? Teye shatam manushya gandharvanam anandah sa eko deva gandharvanam anandah. Then that 100 yields to 1, is reduced to 1 at another level of a higher status. Then what? Shrotriyasya chaka mahatasya. It's not that by this time the Shrotriya and the Akamahata, the one who is free of, one who has Vairagya, it's not that by this time the person has acquired Chilajana, the deer skin, and in the next level the person has also got Kamandalu. Nowadays Kamandalu is very expensive, yeah, because it has to come all the way from Seychelles. Before it was very easy, now Kamandalu very expensive. Especially they put a little silver, cow's face in the kettle and they handle, very expensive. So by the next Shrotriya Akamata, the person has acquired Kamandalu, now the thatched hut, now multi-technology, digitalized ashram. No! There is no growth, anything in the Shrotriya Akamata is unchanged. Then the Deva Gandharva becomes, Ajanam, Ajan, Devanam, Ananda, multiplied by 100, Shrotriya remains the same, Akamahata remains the same. It's not that they have opened one more branch of the ashram, no? And then what? Then from Deva Gandharva you go to the other, from the Ajan, Ajan, Deva you go to Pitriloka Ananda, and by this time the Shrotriya Akamahata has opened a overseas ashram branch, no? Really, it's the same. Even if they may have opened an ashram, that's not anything to do with the level of happiness that they command. Has nothing to do with their possessions. Then Pitraloka, then after that you see it becomes smaller and smaller karma devas. Who are these karma devas? The ones because of good karma they have attained that situation. They go to heaven and become butlers of other devatas, bringing coffee for Indra. This is what it is. Then after that, 32 karma devas and a few other devatas, Indra, Varuna, Agni, Vayu, Yama, etc. And then Indra's boss, Indra himself, Indra's Ananda, all variable, is tethered on the position which is mithya, is tethered on a time-bound experience which is mithya. Here we are talking of satyam which is experience-less, which is the nature of the experiencer that shines in and through every experience, that which is invariable, which is constant. So, eko brahmana ananda. Finally, we come to the ananda commanded by Brahman itself. And what is that? Who does that really belong to? the one who is the knower of Brahman. Brahmavid Brahmaiva Bhavati, the knower of Brahman is nothing other than Brahman. Shrotriyasya cha kamaha tasya. Oh, and then you have to multiply. Teye shatam brahmana, you know, brahmana ananda. No. That which is not subject to multiplication, that which is constant, which is not subject to any kind of division, increase, decrease. So the Upanishad stops there. The Mimamsa is complete, the analysis is complete, there is nothing more to analyze, there is nothing more to add, there is nothing more to subtract. The infallible have been discovered as oneself. What more is there? Limitless is oneself. What is there to analyze? What is there to subtract? What is there to add? What is there to, you know, derive? There is no derivation. That's why it concludes, Sayaschayam Purushe, Yaschasavadityay. One who shines with the effulgence of a thousand suns. This is this Purusha, this cosmic person. First the Purusha was a Purusha in the sense of the one confined to this body-mind-sense complex, or so he thought, so she thought. The one who is trapped in the citadel, a fortress of nine gates. But now this Purusha is an entirely different derivation. Not Purishete, not the one who sleeps in the citadel, lives in the citadel, but the other Purusha, which is that? The same Purusha with a different understanding. Sarvam Purayati, that which fills up, accommodates everything like space. Even accommodates space. This Purusha, this is the growth. This is the growth of the person exposed to this teaching. But it has to be consistent. Once in a while, you know, kabhi kabhi, you cannot do. You have to be constantly committed to this teaching. You've talked about that commitment. What happens if I'm not committed? Then one is fit to be committed elsewhere. Yeah. So, fit for commitment. Yeah. So then, this is what it is. So this Shrotriya Akamahata, you know, completely free, immeasurable. And this Purusha, Yo Asau Adityah, just like the sun, shines upon everything, limitlessly shines. And what happens to this person after the body drops away is also described elsewhere in the Upanishad and even in this piece that we are studying. Natasya pranaha utkramanti. The pranas don't rise. Prana doesn't rise means the subtle body does not get up after the physical body drops. The physical body joins the physical elements, ashes, dust. The subtle body joins the subtle element because the prana is not powered by desire. Yeah. Akamahata. So the prana is fueled by desire, and the fueled by desire, that prana seeks other bodies. No. That's why here also. Etamannamana asman lokat pretya. Two meanings for that we'll see. Having departed from this body, or having departed from this body of ignorance, both you can take. Etamannamayam atmanam upasankramati. Crosses this identification with I am just the body. Etam pranamayam atmanam upasankramati. Crosses the identification I am as good as my respiration, my digestion, my circulation, etc. Etam manomayam atmanam upasankramati. Crosses the identification with the mind. Etam vijnanamayam atmanam upasankramati. Crosses the identification I am the doer, the controller of everything. Etam anandamayam atmanam upasankramati. Crosses the identification of why me, why this is happening to me, the bhokta. Sa ekah saya evam with means the one who understands this way. Asman lokat pretya. Having departed from this tamasik, having woken up from this ajnana nidra suptaha, from this eternal sleep of ignorance, one is awoken to a new reality where these identifications cease to operate and bother the person and make the person miserable. Tadapi esha shlokaha bhavati. This is the shloka from the Rig Veda that is iterated in the Yajurveda. This is what Ananda is. This is what answers the question, what is Ananda? This is what it is. that which is myself, that which is not subject to addition, subtraction, multiplication, that which is not a special experience outside of myself that I have to gain, that which shines in and through all experiences, miserable or otherwise, that which leaves me without any pressure to strive, that which, you know, gives me the contentment that I seek through various pursuits, that is Ananda, that is myself. Om Tat Sat. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnam Dachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om.
Thank you.
Can I be the quick announcement?